In recent times, one area of the United States has reigned supreme above all others for having the highest frequency of volcanic eruptions. While many people might initially assume that I am talking about Hawaii, I am instead referring to a far larger state with nearly double the number of erupting volcanoes in any given year, Alaska. Alaska contains 7 of the 10 most active volcanoes in the United States, along with a grand total of 88 active or potentially active volcanoes. Many geologists and students alike know that the vast majority of these are located within the 1,800-mile-long Aleutian volcanic arc, which is caused by the subduction of the Pacific plate underneath the North American plate. The melted material from this collision then migrates upwards, often intruding into the crust and occasionally producing eruptions, forming a chain of volcanoes. And yet, unknown to many, this is not the only area of Alaska which is the site of volcanic activity. For example, the largest singular Holocene or post-last glacial period lava flow in Alaska erupted 400 miles away from the edge of the Aleutian volcanic arc on the sparsely populated Seward Peninsula around the year 295. This lava flow was massive, covering a grand total of 227.9 square kilometers or 88 square miles in a distinctive layer of black lava. Or, 200 miles east-southeast of Fairbanks is the Prindle volcano which, although extinct, somewhat randomly rises above the surrounding landscape far away from any other notable volcanic features. These two volcanoes mark portions of the other 4 swaths of Alaska that contain volcanic provinces other than the Aleutian volcanic arc, with each volcanic province having differing compositions and the volcanoes within them having different appearances. This video will briefly cover each of these 4 other provinces and discuss why they exist. With 2 of the 12 volcanoes in Alaska not in the Aleutian volcanic arc and 9 of Canada's 19 volcanoes is a province known as the Northern Cordilleran Volcanic Province. This province could best be described as a broad continental rift where every year the crust within it spreads apart to the east and west by as much as 2 centimeters or 0.79 inches. But why is this rifting occurring in the first place? The answer can be owed to a major force 1,700 kilometers to the south-southeast or off the western coast of Canada's Vancouver Island is a tectonic plate boundary. There, what is known as a mid-ocean ridge is creating new crust, depositing it onto the ocean floor and pushing 2 tectonic plates apart. Around 20 million years ago, a block of the Pacific Plate was subducting underneath Alaska and British Columbia, heading towards the northeast due to it being slowly rotated in a clockwise manner. Then, 15 million years ago, a distant mid-ocean ridge began producing new crust at a higher rate than the rotational motion of this tectonic block, causing the entire block to suddenly start moving towards the northwest. This dragged adjacent rock with it on the North American plate, and with this process still ongoing today, it is slowly extending a section of this plate, causing the modern rifting we observe. The aforementioned rifting does not occur along a singular fault or crack, but rather through numerous faults spread out over a wide area, which has created numerous half-grabens. These faults create a path of least resistance for molten rock to intrude into, which allows it to intrude into the crust and occasionally erupt, forming a chain of volcanoes. However, since the rifting is occurring in an uneven manner, generally speaking, the further to the extreme north or extreme south you go in this province, the weaker the rifting becomes. Alaskan volcanoes in this province include a sliver of Canada's Iskut-Unuk River Cones and the Bem Canal Rudyard Bay volcano. Meanwhile, in far western Alaska, 5 volcanoes are part of what is known as the Bering Sea Basalt province. Here, there are numerous widely spaced volcanic fields that contain monogenetic vents, which each only erupt once, forming cinder cones, spatter cones, and Mars. However, hence the name of this field, the most prominent feature these vents produce are large fluid basalt lava flows, which could theoretically cover upwards of 100 square miles in a singular eruption. The exact cause of this province is unclear, although there does seem to be increased heat flow over a broad area in a manner which suggests a low level of backward spreading is occurring here. Additionally, the slow extensional forces in the region have created a series of large strike slip faults which accommodate some of this motion, creating weak spots in the crust which magma can erupt through. Also, partial melting of underlying oceanic crust is involved, possibly due to this being an unusually broad back arc region. Heading back to the southeast, there are three volcanoes in the panhandle of Alaska which seem to be related to the presence of the tectonic plate boundary marked by the Queen Charlotte Fairweather Fault. This fault seemingly dips to the east, meaning that denser oceanic lithosphere at a certain depth is placed underneath continental lithosphere. Both oceanic and continental lithosphere then experience partial melting, using related fault lines as weak spots to intrude into the crust and sometimes erupt onto the surface. The most notable volcano in this province is the Mount Edgecombe stratovolcano, which has been experiencing a deep magmatic intrusion since 2018. Our final province contains two of North America's tallest volcanoes and several of its highest peaks, which, named after its most active volcano, Mount Wrangell, is known as the Wrangell Volcanic Belt. This volcanic belt exists due to a somewhat unusual tectonic plate boundary. While yes, the Pacific Plate is subducting underneath the North American Plate here, it is not a part of the Aleutian Volcanic Arc. As the subducting plate portion is unusually thick, it is subducting at an abnormally shallow angle, and most importantly, a section of it has geologically recently broken off. As a result, partial melting of this broken-off sinking subducted slab, along with the upwelling mantle material moving to replace the space it once occupied, has created volcanism on the surface. This belt produced two of the largest explosive volcanic eruptions of the Holocene epoch via Mount Churchill, but it seems to be dominated by relatively gas-poor and voluminous andesitic eruptions which form large shield volcanoes. Do you have any further questions? Be sure to let me know in the comments section below. As a final note, I would like to thank this channel's patrons on Patreon and channel members on YouTube.